And good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Mobile Apps for Canvas. Today we're going to look at accessing Canvas from a mobile device, specifically using the mobile apps for teachers and students, two separate apps that you can download for free from the your Android or iOS app stores. I know most of you, but just in case I'm new to someone, I'm Dave Giberson. I'm an old instructional design coordinator at Online Learning Pathways at the district. I retired about 3 years ago, but I've come back to help out in the current craziness. And I'm always happy to hear from you. I'll be working at least through the end of June with them. And they've asked me to work a number of hours, so don't ever hesitate to send me an email or contact me in any way. I'm always happy to hear from you. And we'll be running these training and help sessions at a high pace for at least the first couple, 3 weeks of the remainder of the term, and for however long thereafter they're needed. So, many of your students, I think you're going to find, are going to be accessing their online resources, both synchronous with Zoom and asynchronous through Canvas, through their mobile devices. Too many of them don't have any other way to do it. Many of them don't have computers anymore. And so it's incumbent upon us to understand the capabilities we have there and to make sure that we keep that in mind when we're designing instructional content. The good news is that the mobile access has gotten so good that you don't really have to worry too much about students not being able to consume certain content or carry out certain tasks from their phones. The mobile apps for Canvas are so much more powerful than the ones we used to have for Blackboard. And when they run into something that they can't do at all on the mobile app, which is rare, they can also bring up Canvas in their phone's browser and use it that way as well. And Canvas's interface is highly adaptive. That is, it adapts to the size of the screen that the person is viewing it on very well. It can detect the type of device that the user is employing to access Canvas, and that varies how it displays content on the screen. So automatically, without you having to do anything to make it happen. So the user experience on the portable device is much, much, much better than it was in Blackboard. Blackboard's probably better now too, but Canvas was a leader in that. There are two mobile apps for Canvas. Let me show you those. I'm going to be sharing my screen most of the time now. I do have you all muted, but I left open the option for you to unmute yourselves and ask a question or make a comment. We do have 34 folks in this session, which is one of the smaller sessions we've had lately. But as long as we're fairly brief when we do that and so on, I'd like to encourage you to do that. Though I will also be making good use of the chat tool for most questions. If it's not something that's immediately urgent for you to understand something that's on the screen, or for you to tell me, like, I forgot to share my screen or something like that, if you wouldn't mind putting your questions in the chat tool. The chat tool is accessible through the menu at the bottom of the screen on computers, the Zoom control menu. If you don't see that menu, just mouse over where you're seeing me, and that menu should pop up at the bottom of the screen. If you're on a mobile device, just tap the screen and you should see the menus pop up. And most of the menu items will be at the bottom of the screen there as well. But the chat tool on a computer will be in the menu at the bottom of the screen. You just click on that little chat icon, the cartoon balloon, and you will get a chat box that has a little text box at the very bottom that says type message here. And you just type something in there and press enter, and we'll see it. And if you will go ahead and put your questions in that chat box as we go along, I promise you I will not leave today until all your questions are answered. Somebody asked how did I mute everyone? That is done through the participants tool. And I need to mention that as well for people on a mobile device. The chat tool is under the participants link on your mobile device menu. So to get to chat, you have to tap on participants first, and then in the lower left-hand corner of the box, you'll see a link to the chat. And you can chat from your mobile device just as effectively as you can from a computer. Typing's a little slower, but other than that, it works fine. There's also in the participants box, when you're a host, a button that says mute all, and that's how I muted everyone here. And when you mute everyone, you have the option to allow them to unmute themselves later, or you can prevent them from doing that. If you have a huge meeting and you, in order to maintain control, you just have to be the only one talking as the host, you have that option to lock everyone else's microphone out of the meeting. But I don't like to do that, because the best part of a Zoom meeting is usually the back and forth. This is intended as a two-way communication tool. So I won't do that unless I have to, okay? And most of you have been in a lot of these meetings, so you know the deal on that. I will be spending most of my time today sharing my screen, which is Zoom's best capability. I'm going to go ahead and do that now. I'll make sure I've got computer sound shared just in case I decide I need to play a video. And I'll click share, and you should now be seeing my computer desktop. I'm going to move this control bar out of the way so that's not covering up anything you want to see. I'm also moving my video windows out of the way. I've got three monitors on this machine, so I can keep them off to the side that I don't need. Having multiple monitors, two especially, is handy when you're teaching Zoom, because you can stage windows on the monitor that you're not sharing and bring stuff over in a controlled fashion without having to start everything fresh from the from your single screen. All righty. So I'm going to bring up my little document camera, which is another very handy thing when you're lecturing from Zoom. This is a little secondary camera, which I need to focus. Button on this camera does that. And this document camera allows you to show three-dimensional objects like my iPhone here. Or if I flip that legal pad over, I can write on it with the Sharpie, and it's better than a whiteboard really on the wall, because it's a lot easier to write legibly on it. It's the best way to replace your classroom whiteboard in a Zoom meeting.
Would you repeat that, please?
Yes. I'm sorry?
Could you repeat how you can bring up a whiteboard on your cell phone?
That's not exactly what I said. I can bring a camera image up on my shared screen on a computer. You'd have to originate this from a computer. And indeed, I strongly recommend that Zoom meetings should be originated from a computer or a desktop computer or a laptop, if you can possibly do that, rather than a mobile device, because the mobile devices do have limitations. particularly in hosting a Zoom session. So what I've done here is bring a window up on my shared screen that contains an application that works with my little USB document camera. And it puts onto my shared screen what my document camera is seeing. And I can answer more questions about that later. That's something I go into a lot more detail on in a Zoom introduction, but I just wanted you to see that this sort of thing is possible. And these document cameras have started becoming available again for purchase. For a while, they were cleared out of all the online stores. But I've seen last couple of days, I've seen them reappear. And it's a very, very handy thing to have when you're having to lecture on Zoom from home. So, and one of the things I can do is show you my iPhone and show you how to use the mobile apps, the Canvas mobile apps on the iPhone. Let me make this share as big as I can so that you can see it easier. And I can zoom in a little bit onto the phone using this software. This is just one type of document camera and visualizer software, but these are the people who kind of pioneered this sort of device, so they still make the best ones. It's iPevo is the company, IPEVO. So you can pretty well see my iPhone screen there. The tiny print is a little blurred, I'm sure, but it's usually legible enough. So here are two Canvas mobile apps right here, the teacher app and the student app. And both have surprisingly great capabilities. But I don't want to create an unrealistic expectation. You can't create a course and do everything that you need to run the course from the teacher app. It has its limitations, mainly because of the limitations of the phone. Students, on the other hand, there's not a lot that students can't do that they need to do in Canvas on the student app. So if anything, relative to the tasks needed, the student app is more powerful than the teacher app, if anything. We'll take a look at the teacher app first. And sorry, we're going to get my news pop-ups here. Hopefully it won't be anything too distressing. So to go into the teacher app, of course, I just tap on it. And the first thing we have to do is get logged into our Canvas system. You just tap Find My School, and you just type in San Diego on your phone's keyboard. I more or less spelled that correctly. And there, halfway down, is the San Diego Community College District. That's us. Just tap on that. And we'll go to the mobile login screen for Canvas. And you log in the same way you always do with your user ID, your 10-digit user ID. My user ID is not 10 digits. I hope that's 7. Yeah, I think so. And let's see if I can. I want to pull this away to put my password in. Since on the phone you can see the password, at least briefly. I was hoping I got it right. Yep. When you get it right, you just immediately go to your Canvas dashboard, just like you would if you were on a computer. The dashboard is presented in a slightly differently. It's only two tiles across, and then you have to just keep scrolling up to get more of them. That's what I meant by an adaptive display. Canvas realized that I was accessing it through a phone and sent the screens formatted differently. Very, very good. There's the system announcement at the top, which hopefully everybody heeded this morning, to publish your Canvas course so that your students can see it. If you don't publish the course, the students can't see it. We can't control that through integration control anymore. So that's probably the most important thing you could do this morning. So this looks very familiar. We can just enter a course here. Find one that would be appropriate. That's a good one right there. Just tap the tile and in we go. And here's what the course looks like. You see basically your course menu when you go in. You've got some settings up here in the right hand corner. Let's see what we can do there. Oops, getting a little crosstalk there. Let me mute everyone again. There we go. Let's see, how many people do we have with us? So 48. Wow, it is growing. We can, let's see, it looks like we can, nope, we can't change the name, but we can change what the front page is, what appears first when the students see it. So that's where we can do that. And then up here on the right, when we're done with that sort of thing, we click done. Didn't make any changes this time. And now you get your course menu. Let's just work our way down and see what, and at this point we are in the, at the bottom we are in the courses area of the app. We also have our to-do list and our inbox. We have access to our inbox from here. So we can read messages that come into our Canvas inboxes, and we can send messages all from the phone. So, but we're in the courses area right now. So we have our normal course menu with announcements. We can view announcements that we have created. We can add announcements using the plus sign up here. Anytime you see that plus sign in the Canvas interface, it's an opportunity to add something to Canvas. So we can punch that and we get a screen where we can add an announcement. You just title it, description, title it rather, and then just type. And you tap in that description box there, which is actually your announcement text. You get your phone keyboard popping up and you type. You have, this is a very small subset of the capability you have in the Canvas rich content editor when you're accessing Canvas through a computer. It is, you can, as you see the icons right along here, you can go back, you can undo something, you can bold text, italicize text, change the color of text, and it's a little hard to tell, the icons are so small, but you can start a bulleted list or a numbered list, or you can create a hyperlink, and that's about it. You're not going to be able to do things like, or I haven't been able to figure out a way to do things like embed video in an announcement that you could do on a computer. So you don't have all of the capability here that you would have if you were using the computer, but you have enough to in a pinch, post an announcement that your students will be able to use. And if, it's something you would use when you were on the road or away from your computer for whatever reason, you could still post an announcement and certainly can, and the students can certainly read them. And you can bring the screen down at any time. And when you're done, oh, and you can attach files to the announcement up here. by tapping the plus sign up here. And on this, on the iPhone, that attachments can be an audio file that you record on the phone. You can use your camera. You can upload a file from your phone or choose from your library. So that's your basically your photos on this phone. I'm going to back out of that. So, and then always somewhere there'll be a done button that you can use to get back out. And done here again. I didn't save anything, so I'll just cancel that. I didn't create an announcement. So you can read and create announcements on your phone. And I've got a back button. Now let me focus this again. It's getting a little fuzzy. That camera has a way of doing that sometimes when it keeps trying to adjust to when I stick my finger under it. So that's a bit better. So I can go back to where I was, and then back to my course menu. I can go to discussion forums. I can see my existing forums. I can visit them. Like this forum actually has some posts in it. If I tap on that one, I see the posts. And this is a cool display in some ways. This was a graded discussion forum. So I can see here that I've graded 3 people, but that there's one post that I haven't graded that needs grading, and 3 people in the course haven't submitted anything to it. That's displayed, I think, better than the way it displays in the computer interface for discussions in Canvas. Here's the instructions for the discussion forum and the reply button. And students will see pretty much the same display. And then they can reply to the initial instructions in the post, or they can reply to each other's posts down here. Every one of these posts has a reply button associated. This, they can do just about everything with the discussion forums that they can do on their computer. Or let's just say that if they don't have a computer and they're accessing Canvas through a smartphone, they can participate fully in the discussion forum. And if somebody hits reply, they get the same editor interface we saw a minute ago. He said, and they can type a message up here and get their keyboard, and they can attach a file. Just like you could attach a file to an announcement, they can attach files to their discussion posts. So this pretty much full functionality on the phone for the discussions. And it's quite easy to read them. So discussions work great on the phone for you and for the students. Your interface and the student's interface of the discussions are about the same, except that, I forgot to mention that you can create new discussions by tapping that add button there. So you could, if you were out and about and you suddenly felt the need for a new discussion forum in your course, you could tap that in right now. What you could not do is link it into one of your modules, which you'd certainly want to do as quickly as you could. The one thing that you, we'll talk about that when we get to the modules link here. So let's go back. Pages. You've got your pages tool. You can see all of your Canvas pages that you've created. Just by scrolling up and down in the usual way. And you can add new pages. Type a title for the page. You can type you can put text in, and you can create hyperlinks in a page. You can't embed images or video from your phone. They haven't figured that out yet. And you can decide, and you can publish the page or not, as you prefer. So all that's, you have all that capability. You just don't have full, again, you don't have the full functionality of the rich content editor in Canvas. But it's quite good for being working off a 5.5-inch diagonal screen here on this old iPhone. It'll look even better and work even better on something more modern. I refuse to upgrade my iPhone because I use the headphone jack for too many things in using the phone. And this is the last iPhone model that had a headphone jack on it. When this one dies, I'm going Android. Right, cancel. And back to the course menu again. You have access to your file manager. I'm not quite sure why you'd need that out and about, though you can load new files onto the system with the plus sign there. Quizzes. You can see all your quizzes. You'll note there is no plus sign up here in the upper right-hand corner of this screen. So you can't create a quiz on the phone. But you can view and edit the ones that you've already put up there, like this first one here, just for example. We get the status of the quiz. We see who's submitted it, or how many have submitted it, and how many have not. We get all this. We can edit the quiz. We've got an edit button up in the upper right-hand corner. But what we can edit here seems to be just these test options. We can't edit the questions. So at least I've not been able to find any way to do that. But we can set all of the various parameters, the test options for it. And from here, if we have if this is a quiz that is not completely gradable by the system, we're told that there's an attempt that needs grading. We can tap on that, and we can go and grade it. The performance, this is an old phone, so the performance sucks a bit. But there's the mobile results for this quiz for the student. And if you scroll down, you'll see that question two here was an essay question. And you can scroll things back and forth so you can read the entire question. And you can grade it right there. So you can grade. Boy, we sure can do that on the Blackboard mobile apps. So if you're stuck somewhere and all you've got your phone, God forbid you're in somewhere waiting for a COVID test or something, or just sitting in your car waiting for the grocery store to clear out until it's safe to go in or something, you can sit here and you can grade your submissions in Canvas. That's new territory for me anyway. And you can always go back and back and get back to where you were. I'm not going to try to show you every possible option here that you can play with this yourself and see. And there are good Canvas guides for using the mobile apps for both faculty and students. So you can get a full look at the total capability. I just think it helps to see them actually in operation, which is why we scheduled this session yay those many months ago, and we didn't have any idea how critical it was going to be for our students to be able to do this, and for our faculty, because everybody was going to be remote. Never dreamed that. Modules, the modules is probably the weakest part of the mobile app for teachers. You can view your modules, but you'll notice there's no option to create modules on this screen. And tighten up that focus a little bit. Nor can you add links to the modules. You can just view them basically. That was my getting started module one. This course has been marked up so much it no longer makes a whole lot of coherent sense, but there's the beginnings of the modules I originally had in there. I've got my getting started module and then my topic modules below it. So I can access all this content. I can bring up my syllabus, view it. And the students, of course, can do the same thing. And that's not a great document for a mobile device, obviously, but students can, or you can, pinch Zoom and move this around.
Dave, this is Linda Morgan. Yeah. Can you hear
me? Yes.
Hi. Well, you look great. Idaho's doing well with you.
I'm trying to do the mountain man thing. Somebody told me the other day I should get myself a buckskin jacket with fringes and everything and do a Wild Bill Cody.
Oh yeah, that's what you remind me of.
Buffalo Bill Cody imitation. But anyway, yes.
I was going to ask. I loved working with Jing, and then of course that evolved, and they had Screencast. But I have now been using Snagit. Have you used Snagit?
I use Snagit every day.
Okay.
Multiple times a day.
All right.
I do almost all of my screencast recording in Snagit.
Okay.
And if I have to edit it, then I can drop it very easily into Camtasia and edit it. But the recorder in Snagit, the workflow in Snagit is the best I've ever seen. And if you have to do a lot of screencasts, if you're giving student feedback that way, every time you interact with it, you save a few seconds over something like Screencast-O-Matic, and it adds up to days. I've saved days of of my life.
It's just using Snagit. It's so easy. That's what I like about it, and it's local. It's on your own machine, and okay, just want to ask about that.
And even though Screencast-O-Matic is nominally free, in fact, to really make use of it, you have to pay them $20 a year to get more than 15 minutes of recording time and things like that. Mm-hmm. And Snagit only costs you, an educational license for Snagit costs you $30. And that's good forever.
Yeah, so. If anybody's listening to this and you haven't seen or used Snagit, it's very, very easy to choose to either just select an area of your screen to copy or to select and start recording and turn your recording off and manipulate it. So that's what we're talking about, and then save those files and share them.
But actually that's the process we call screencasting. Mm-hmm. But in effect, I am doing screencasting right now because I did remember to turn on the Zoom recording before I started this. And everything that you are seeing right now is being recorded along with my narration. So Zoom is also a terrific screencasting tool. And every Zoom meeting that you do is by default a screencast. Interesting thought. Okay, but back to the mobile app. I'm sorry, I'm easily distracted when it comes to that topic. So it is possible to, even when documents are small print and so on, the students usually have the option to zoom in and zoom out on their mobile devices. So that makes it even more realistic an option. So you can see your module content, you just can't alter it on the phone. And that's an improvement up until a few months ago or sometime in 2019, you couldn't even view the modules. So this is a huge improvement. people. You can see your roster, and there's nothing especially remarkable about that. You can integrate with Google. The LTI integration with Google Drive works. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that, or the attendance tool, which is not doing us much good right now. The attendance tool in Canvas allows you to take attendance in a physical classroom, or you could use it to record your attendance in a Zoom session too, I suppose. I hadn't thought about that, but you know, it's going to be a while before any of us see a physical classroom, so I'm not going to worry too much about that. The Zoom LTI link will work. You can get, I haven't tried the analytics button. Let me punch that and see if we can get a reasonable view of the analytics here. Well, it looks like it's doing something. Yeah. But everything is compressed, and I have not been able to get this thing to flip. Oh, it did. The analytics display did flip. Okay, great. The other displays did not, but this one does. So you can get your basic course analytics. Oh, you can get pretty much full access to your analytics. You can check student by student. Wow. That's most of what you can see on your computer screen. So, that's a nice surprise. Let me induce it to turn back to portrait mode here. I sure could not do this without my little document camera. I can't emphasize enough how handy these things are if you're stuck lecturing through Zoom. With that document camera, you have just about every bit of capability that you have in the classroom. Without it, you're a little bit handicapped because the virtual whiteboard that you can share in Zoom is highly limited, and it's difficult to write and draw on, even if you have a fairly nice graphics tablet. With the document camera, you can just show three-dimensional objects like we're doing here, or you can write on the piece of paper, a legal pad or whatever, and lecture as you would from the whiteboard in class. And if anything, it's easier than writing on the whiteboard in class. One thing, you get less exercise. You're sitting down and comfortable. So these are exceptionally exceptionally handy little items. And we have a video online on our on-demand video site that shows you how to improvise one of these document cameras from your cell phone. So it's something you can probably have no matter what. Okay, all right, that display didn't, that's interesting. It finally decided to tilt on me there. Let me bring it back. There we go. Finally, nicely came back. I believe I had, there was one thing I had not done in that course menu that I wanted to show you. Let's go back to that. You do have access to the assignments tool. Remember, in Canvas, the assignments tool is sort of a misnomer. This tool should be named assessments, not assignments, because this shows every gradable item in your course: quizzes, gradable discussions, and homework assignments. I've never heard a convincing explanation of why they don't do that. But anyway, as long as you realize that this tool is going to show you all gradable assessments in the course, it's easy enough to deal with. So I just need to get over it, right? There's our And it's even keeping track of my assignment groups up here. This is the test assignment group that I created for my quizzes. And then when I scroll up to the bottom of that, then it automatically shows my discussions, my graded discussions. And then these are my homework assignments. That's really a masterpiece of mobile interface design, I gotta say. They did a good job on that. And when you go into the assignments tool, you can see when you've got something that needs grading. And that's not one I wanna get into, but let's see. Oh, darn it, the writing assignment doesn't have any ungraded ones. Oh, this is a discussion here, and two people need grading in that discussion. If I tap on that, oh my goodness, Jane posted late. Oh well. And now there's actually a mobile grading interface here. I can see Jane's posts, however many of them there are. Down at the bottom, I have a tab for grades, comments, and files. Let me sharpen that up a little bit. I've apparently got this thing set to autofocus. I probably shouldn't have done that, because every time I stick my finger under there, it tries to focus on my finger, and it softens the focus on what's below there. I could change that, but I don't want to take the time right now. So I can, if I want to grade this, I can go to grades, and I can even see a rubric if there is one. There is one, isn't that cool? Let's see, plus sign will allow me to add the grade, right? Customize the grade out of 15. So I just graded it. I can leave comments. I can type a comment down here in the comment box. Or I can hit this little plus sign here, and I nearly fell out of my chair when I saw this the first time. And I can record audio and video right off my phone and have it become a part of the grading record in Canvas, just like I can with my webcam from my computer. Pretty cool, either audio or video. And done. And move on. And once I get into the grading interface, here's one that's got three people in need grading. When I finish up grading test student one, I can just swipe left and go right to test student two and move on and not have to back out and come back in again for each different student. So it's really quite an efficient interface. And this is the same basic interface you would also get on an Android tablet or an iPad, which would have a much bigger screen. So this makes it really, it might be just about as easy to grade, say, on your iPad as it would on your computer. So the ability to do this from anywhere with any device is really quite remarkable. We're used to computers doing things magically, but we're seeing just a quantum leap in the capability of mobile devices to interact with complex systems like Canvas, or Zoom for that matter, that has really just taken off over the last 2 or 3 years. Because that's the way the vast majority of web access in the world is done now, through through mobile devices. Alrighty, so that's how you can do your grading. You can either go to the assignments tool or the discussions tool or the quizzes tool, and the app will tell you if something needs grading, and you can just tap on it and you can go grade it. When you have 20 minutes waiting 6 feet away from everybody else, or you're sitting at the mechanics or something, and you just have a few minutes, you can pull out your phone and you can do quite a lot of management and interaction grading in your Canvas course when you just so you don't waste it, and that time won't be wasted from the standpoint of getting something done and having it done by the time you get back home, and maybe you can sit down and stream Netflix in standard definition for a little while and relax instead of having to go and grade your stuff in your online class. So it's a great time saver. It's great productivity enhancer, and saves you time in the long run. Terrific capability here. Let's see. And I'm seeing some good questions come by here. And when I finish this tour of the teacher app, I'm going to go and answer those before we go on to the student app, because you've already seen a lot of what you're going to see in the student app. A lot of it looks the same. They just don't have capability to add stuff and grade stuff and so on. But they see the content in much the same way you do. So let's go back here. Whoop, I didn't mean to do that. Done. Go back to my courses area and back to, and that's pretty much the course menu in that one. That's just a nickel tour of the app. I encourage you to try it. We do have mobile guides. Let's see if I can find those. Here we go. Here's Canvas. Help. Canvas guides. And you can make your way through the menus like this, but to tell you the truth, you're probably going to get information quicker just by going to Google and typing in Canvas mobile teacher app. Mobile guides, Canvas teacher. You have a guide for iOS and Android. The apps are a little different on the Android devices. So to see the one that for the phone I'm using, here's everything you need to know. And okay. Yes.
Well, I just said thank you. That was good. And I have to tell you, I used Google today because you said to use it the other day. And it was wonderful.
There's not much you can't find out about technical tools on Google, and Canvas especially, because not only is Canvas used all over the world, but for some reason, the people who use Canvas seem to be more of a sharing lot than the people who used to use Blackboard and other systems like this. So it's just a massive amount of helpful information about Canvas online that you can access by just typing a question into Google. And it comes from exceptionally credible sources in many cases, not just from the company itself and structure, but from places like Yale, use Canvas. Brown, Northwestern, you all use Canvas. I know Berkeley uses Canvas as well. So there's some fantastic information out there. You're never without help in Canvas just by going to Google. And it's usually the fastest way to find what you're looking for. You don't have to work your way through a bunch of menus like I was about to do there. And of course, there are teacher guides and there are student guides as well. Mobile guides, Canvas student, Android and iOS. So you're never without capability or never without help. Let's see, is there anything? Oh, yes, there is down here at the bottom. Let me get this away from that little icon on my visualizer screen. This little icon right here comes with the visualizer software for the camera, and occasionally it gets in the way. But you've got, it's real hard to see that, but that's your to-do list. God almighty, I've got 241 items in my to-do list. Oh, that's a little too... Hopefully not all those are real to-do items. That's the way we're all feeling right now. But you can also go in here and get your, this is in effect a needs grading list as well, like we had in Blackboard. So you can do your grading from here as well. And you can get to your Canvas inbox. And of course you can read your messages, but you can also send messages using a little plus sign up there. You do have to select course as usual. You can do that. It seems to put the one you've used most recently up at the top, which is handy. And you can decide to whom to send it. It's just like in the same capability you have on the computer interface, you can send to your students. You can all send to all students, or you can send to individual students. And you have the option to send the individual message to each student so they don't see that it's been sent to other students as well. And then you can compose your message on your phone keyboard. And when you're done, and then there's a send button up here when you're done. And you can attach files. The iPhone used to have a massive lack of capability in terms of storing files on the phone. It used to be the only thing you could file type you could store on your phone was a picture that you had taken with your iPhone's photo app. But recent releases of the operating system, iOS, I'm not sure if this appeared in iOS 11 or iOS 12, but recent upgrades to that have produced a file storage area, a file manager on the iPhone. So if I want to attach a file to this message, yeah, I know I don't have any attachments yet. I can add, hit the add button there. And I can record an audio message right now and attach that. I can use the camera and record a video message. I can upload a file from my iPhone, or I can choose from my library. If I go upload file, this is my file area on the iPhone. And that's a Word document that I actually created on the iPhone in the Word app on the iPhone and saved it. So I could attach that to this document. I think I just did. Nope. Ah, that did it. I just didn't hit it, right? Done. So now I've attached a file to that, which can be just about any kind of computer files you might have stored on the iPhone. And then I can send it. So it's a little more awkward and it's a little different from the computer interface. But once you get used to it, there's a tremendous amount that you can do from the teacher app in terms of managing your course. If not really creating it, though you can create some content. You can create pages from the phone, limited pages, but pages nonetheless. Sooner or later, they're going to give us the capability to link those into our modules as well. And then it'll be a lot more useful. But you can still do some content creation on the phone. A lot more than I'd expect that you could. So that's kind of the nickel tour of the teacher app. Let me go back. I'm going to go back and start taking some questions here. Because, and we'll take a look at the student app in a minute, but the student app is not, it's just kind of a subset of what the teacher app can do. So we've seen most of the capability. Though we haven't seen the fact, we haven't seen the capability, which just blew me away, for students to actually submit assignments from their phones. They can submit assignments and they can take tests and they can participate in graded discussions. So there's really not a whole lot that a student needs to do in a Canvas course that they can't do from their student app on their phone. Which is good because some of them are just going to have their phones to access it again, particularly students who didn't anticipate signing up for an online course. And that's pretty important. Okay. Let's see, I think we answered the question about playing the movie in Zoom and why the sound was low, because you have to share your computer's sound when you share your screen, if you want to do that. Oh, you're sweet, Leanne. Good to see you all. I think I did mention how to mute everyone. There's a question about how to mute everyone in Zoom. I think we talked about that. If I want to be on both mobile and computer, how do I turn off the sound on either so I do not get feedback? That's in a Zoom session. On the phone, and I'm in Canvas right now. Let me get out of that. If I get into Zoom here, there's my Zoom app. When I put those Canvas apps on my home screen, I sort of move stuff around. I can join this meeting that I'm in right now. My share bar over here tells me that my meeting ID is 391-499-5946. And this is a number you can, of course, share with your students. Though I could just as easily have, if I had the email, if I wanted to go look up the email that Mary sent and that had the link to my personal Zoom meeting room in it, I could have just tapped on that link and the phone would have dropped me right into the meeting, would have automatically started the Zoom app and then have dropped me right into the meeting. I guess that's why they call it a smartphone. But I can join the meeting manually by typing in the meeting ID. Now, I got to do this pretty quickly after I say call using internet audio. The phone's going to come in both my microphone and my speaker on the phone are going to be active. And I'm going to start to get a feedback loop. So I got to tap, mute the microphone, mute the speaker. Wasn't quick enough. That'll die off in a second. I hope. I just muted my
speakers on my computer to stop that. I thought I'd stopped it.
you gotta be quick with this. That's the drawback of having two sound devices open in the same room.
I'm going to leave my speakers off for a second, since I don't need to hear at the moment.
I am still transmitting.
I can hear that coming through on my, just very low on my phone. Doesn't mute. An iPhone, when you mute the speakers, doesn't mute 100%. It mutes to about 95 to 98%. So you can still hear a little bit of that. Let's see if this has died off by now. Nope. I'm going to have to pull this phone out of the meeting in a minute. In answer to your question about how do you mute your computer, you mute your computer speakers on a Windows PC.
I think you can see this. Let me get the phone turned around where I can see what I'm doing a little better. Oh, darn it, you don't see that. Oops.
Let's try that now. Yeah, and I just had that zoomed a little bit. Down in the lower right-hand corner of the Windows screen, in the taskbar, there's a little speaker. There should be a little speaker icon. If you click on that, you will see your volume control. And this button over here on the left will mute your speakers. And you can, of course, turn them down. That's better. I've mostly killed the feedback now, but I'm still getting a little bit of it. And in terms of muting your microphone in Zoom, you just use the mute button in the Zoom menu. So I'm going to take this phone out of the meeting. And that should solve that problem.
Dave, it's Will Burke.
Yes, just a second, let me turn my sound back up. I think I can do that now.
Okay,
there we go.
Hey, I've got a question about students. I'm teaching English. What about students who, don't have access to a computer and are trying to write essays on their phone? What kind of support or direction should I offer them? I'm particular about formatting, right? So,
yeah, I pretty much give up worrying about formatting.
Yeah.
And I'm going to show you how that works in a minute.
Okay.
I got to tell you, typing a long writing assignment on a phone is going to be excruciating.
Okay.
So our expectations are going to have to be a bit adjusted.
Sorry to interrupt. Hey, Will, in the chat, I just posted a link. And since if you're at City, I just emailed everyone too, but the public library partnered with Computers to Kids. So if you have a K-12 student, you can get a laptop for fully loaded with tech support for 100 and a computer for 80. And then hopefully someone in the district is trying to do that for our college students as well, because Palomar just partnered with Shiley and Computers to Kids, and they just handed out 350 computers to Palomar students. So I posted that link in the chat.
All right, thanks. I'll have a look at that.
That's everybody's trying. I know they were talking about, until the stay in place order came out, they were talking about opening the computer labs at the libraries on each campus with appropriate social distancing measures, but we're shut out of that. But let's face it, nothing we do in all probability is going to get computers in the hands of all of our students. Oh my God, we have 40,000 students each semester. So in a lot of cases, the students are going to have to get by on their phones, and we have to be understanding about that. I'll show you how excruciating it is to type on an iPhone here in a second in Word, if you haven't tried it before. So, great questions. So that's how you turn off your sound, and that's how important it is to turn off your sound on one or the other of the two devices. Normally, you'll turn off the sound on the mobile device when you have the computer and the mobile device running in the same room. But there are times when you might want to use the phone instead. Like if you were using the phone as a document camera, you'd want to leave the sound on the phone open and mute the sound on the computer. So now you've got a rough idea of how to do both. And the process on the Mac is not that different from the one on the PC. I can't show you that because I don't have a Mac. But I'm sure you know how to turn the volume up and down on your Mac. For one thing, there's usually a keyboard shortcut or a keyboard option to do that too. All right, good question and very important. Using the phone, I don't see the home page, syllabus, and grades. That's right, you don't. The home page just doesn't show up. What you get is the course menu. There's a link to the home page at the top of the course menu, but I can't get it to bring my home page up. I don't know if that's me or if that's a glitch in the teacher app. You don't see the syllabus tool. That's right. So there you probably... That's another reason to upload your syllabus to a module as a file rather than using that syllabus tool in the course menu in Canvas, or both. You know, do both. Use the syllabus tool is wonderful on a computer, but on a mobile device, it's going to be a lot better if they have their syllabus in a Word document that they can pull up. So you probably want to do both. And grades, we saw where you could find your grades to do grading, but you can't access your gradebook, as far as I know, through the mobile app, the teacher app. You have to do that on the computer. But you can grade. So about the only thing you can't do on the mobile device is set up the gradebook and adjust manually enter grades for into cells in your gradebook, or move grade columns around, or adjust how your grades are computed. But that's not the sort of thing you're probably going to want to do on a mobile device anyway. They're making the assumption that you as teachers, or instructor is making the assumption that you as teachers have access to a computer, but that the mobile device is a convenient adjunct to that that you can use while you're on the go to manage your course, to manage much of your course. Is the mobile device a good tool to complete my lab assignments? I have not tried that. That's a very good question. Does anybody have any experience with that? You can unmute yourself if you need to.
Just could you repeat the question, please?
Yeah, it's the mobile device. Can you do my lab assignments on your mobile device? I don't know. I would be very interested to try that, but I don't have access to any of the MyLab stuff anymore. It would be interesting. If somebody wants to try that, I'll be happy to give you access to a real test student that you can put into your course and see if you can, if you have some test access codes for MyLab. If you want to try that, I can provide you with a real test student to try it with. Yes, ma'am. Somebody was speaking there. We got us mixed in together. Okay. During my first class using Zoom, students commented that I had low bandwidth. How can I improve this situation? Oh, my. That's tough. About all you can do is change your internet service provider or buy more bandwidth from the one you have. Apparently, in your area at that moment in time, there was so much traffic on the your ISP's network that you were being that your bandwidth was a little low. Yes.
in this case, like turning off like other people's like printers or cell phone, does it help actually?
Yes, actually, if you're at home and other people are using the Wi-Fi, like you're sitting there trying to teach your class and somebody in your household is watching a high definition movie on Netflix. Yeah, if you go in and shut the movie off, you'll have better bandwidth. So that's another thing you can do.
Like a turn off their like phones or a TV.
That's right. Really- shut down the phone so it's not using bandwidth. Streaming audio or streaming video are the things that really soak up bandwidth. Just not doing that while you're online is a good thing.
Okay.
But I you get those messages at times anyway, though, if your ISP's network is congested. And there's not much you can do about that.
Because what I have at home is a quite strong one.
I'm sorry?
The bandwidth that I have at home, yeah, supposed to be kind of quite strong, a good one that we pay. So, and today was kind of surprised that the students complained about the low bandwidth.
Right.
Yes, it does.
Zoom might have also been telling them that their bandwidth was low. So that may have been the source of the problem for them. If you're not seeing a warning on your Zoom screen of low bandwidth, it may be their problem and not yours. And that the same possible solutions apply to them. They shouldn't be, you know, doing other things at the same time. They should try to find a better, if they're using a cellular signal, they should try to find a spot where the stronger cell signal.
I see. I'll make that announcement.
Yeah. I'm sorry?
So I will make that as one of the announcements to turn off all the, not using any Wi-Fi.
Right. Okay. And try to maximize your bandwidth if you're on a Wi-Fi, if you're in a public Wi-Fi cloud or if you're using cellular connectivity, try to move around a little bit and find a better spot.
Okay.
I've had to do that myself up here when I've had to do things from a mobile device. Good question.
Thank you.
Students can't hear the videos I play for them through Zoom. Be sure when you share your screen in Zoom that you select share computer sound. Select that option from the share menu. I can't show you that online or in a Zoom meeting, but there's an option to share your computer sound and that will solve that. How can I use Zoom in and Zoom out when I show using IPvo in the share screen? There's a Zoom tool on the IPvo visualizer. It's right there. It's a little magnifying glass. And you can zoom in and out to your heart's content. Thing's almost a microscope. Though if you zoom it in too far, you begin to get pixelation. You can also change your, resolution. I'm only operating at partial at a moderate resolution for this camera that I have. And this one's 6 or 7 years old. The new ones have much higher resolution capability. I can make it sharper by upping my resolution.
Yes, Dave, I didn't get, when I connected my IPvo camera, and using the like a camera app to my laptop, I didn't get that tool bar.
The IPvo visualizer?
Right.
They normally ship that with a camera on a CD.
No, I just checked out that, no manual. I just checked it out. I only see like buttons. Like one is like a taking picture. One is like a focusing.
Right. But so you didn't get the software is what you're saying.
No, I didn't get any software.
Oh, okay. Well, we can fix that. And I'm about to have to go back to the mobile app stuff here in a second. But I wanted to take some of these questions because they're important. I mean, they're very important. Mm-hmm. We can go to the IPVO website. Let me get this out of the way. IPVO.com. Mm-hmm. And somewhere here, software, IPVO Visualizer is free. And you can download it and install it. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And it will work. I'm using it with the first camera they ever made, the oldest one. So you can get that for free.
Okay. Oh, thank you.
And that makes the camera a lot easier to use because instead of having to switch cameras and zoom, you can just bring up the visualizer software. Oops, did I close that? Let me do that. I didn't mean to do that. It just makes using the document camera with Zoom so much simpler because all you have to do is bring up the share your screen with your students and bring up the visualizer software. You don't have to go down into the Zoom menus and swap cameras.
Right.
And when you swap cameras in Zoom, you don't get the ability to invert it and mirror images and things like that. So it may not work at all. So you really, to use an IPVO camera, you really need this IPVO visualizer software, and you can download and install it for free on both PCs and Macs.
Oh, that's great. Thank you so much, Dave.
You bet. That's what we're here for. That's the kind of thing we want to have happen. Okay, so I'm back on my visualizer software, and don't forget you can make it bigger so that your students can see better. And you've got Zoom, you can zoom in and out and so on. This is pretty good though. Let's take a look at the student app. It is right here. It's the same icon, it's just in red instead of gold. Tap on that. And I've already logged in here. You can leave these apps logged in full time so that you don't have to log in every time you go in. I just wanted to show you how to do the login in the teacher app, but this is a test student. This is not like the test student that you have when you click on student view in your course. This is an actual student account in Canvas that we have created to test stuff like this. If you ever need to use one of those, let me know. I can give you access to one of them. Just realize that students in a bunch of different courses and more than one person uses it. So you probably don't want to put anything too confidential or give that student account access to anything too confidential. But that's usually not an issue. So the student app operates very much the same way as the teacher app does. The students enrolled in that same course I was fussing with earlier. Somebody mentioned they couldn't see the front page. And I'm having the same problem. If I tap on that, I should see my front page for that course come up. And I waited quite a while earlier today for this to happen, and it didn't show it to me. I don't know what the significance of that is. It may just be a glitch. It may work later. Because I've got reasonably good bandwidth here. It's nothing like what you all have when you're at the district, but it's pretty good for home bandwidth in the back beyond up here in northern Idaho. So I don't know why that doesn't come up, but we've got all the same menu items. The student can view announcements of all sorts. They can reply. It's funny, announcements from Canvas are almost like a discussion forum. We didn't have that capability in Blackboard. They can see their grades, but if they tap on the right thing, they can see their grades. and they can see, they can even see their, they can take the quizzes from right here, and they can see, they can see what you allow them to see. If they want to see their submission, they just tap here, and there's their actual test paper, quote unquote. They may have to move it back and forth a little bit to see everything, but they can see all of that. They can see the pages that you have shared with. If you share the pages tool with them, they can see your pages. That's something I would normally not want to do. Though this is a way for them to view that page content, but better they should view it in the modules, and they have that capability. The reason that they that's in the app is because they didn't used to be able to view the modules, which given that a Canvas course is built around modules, that made it much less, that was a real problem. But Canvas or Instructure has fixed that. They can go to quizzes and take quizzes. Let's see if this module one quiz, it's closed. So this, I'm not gonna be able to show you that one. Let's try the final quiz here. It appears to be open. Oh, there we go. I can just swipe left. I have no idea what that means in Tinder, but here it means you can take the quiz. Take quiz. There's an essay question. I can type in the answer. Here's a multiple drop-down question. They can select the answers. There's really not much you can throw at them in the way of a test that they can't take on the phone, which is a good thing because, again, some of them are going to be trying to do everything on the phone. And when they get to the bottom, they'll have a submit button. And they can always exit the test there. So they can take quizzes. They can view their module, the content in their modules. There's the syllabus. That's the one they're going to have to zoom to read. They can take this, they can take their quizzes right from here. Take quiz. Have to tell it twice, I guess. Whoops. That appears to be a quiz with no questions in it. Oops, sorry. Let me just exit out of that. Leave. Thank you. So I can pretty much see all of their content. They can even see your embedded videos if you embed them in pages, and they can play them.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Introduction to Screencasting. Screencasting is about the simplest multimedia production technique I know. All you're going to be doing is recording your screen, everything that happens on it, and talk.
The lip sync issues that you're seeing there are in the iPivo Visualizer app. The lip sync on the video that I, if I'm watching it directly on the phone, is fine. But this Visualizer app that we're using here is really designed to display still images of stuff that are not changing, they're not moving rapidly like your lips do when you talk. So there's a lot of latency in the connection between the camera and the app and the software and the computer. So this would not be an ideal way to play a video for your students in your course, to put your iPhone or your Android phone in a, under a document camera and press play. Obviously you have other ways of doing that, but that's why the lip sync there is not a function, is not a problem on the phone. It's a problem in the visualizer software that I'm using to show you my, the picture of my iPhone. So these are really, these little document cameras are designed for documents or three-dimensional images that are not, or three-dimensional objects that are not moving around rapidly. Okay. So I can X out of that. And I can turn that sideways and it'll get the video get bigger as well. So the student could pretty much take the course from their phone. And access, and it's critical that you, and they can access it all through their modules. So if you put all the links to everything that you want them to get to into the modules tool, they'll be able to access content, assessments, and communication tools all from within the modules. They also have access to their calendar, their to-do list, their notifications, if any, and their inboxes, just as you did in the teacher app. And the interface is the same. They can send a message. Just as you can. And what's really remarkable to me, if I get back here to the dashboard, the dashboard area is the course menu as well. If you're in a course, you tap on the dashboard icon at the bottom here, you'll get back to the course. And what's really remarkable is that they can writing assignment. Where did I put that? I guess not. Ah, there it is. Here's a link. This Define Screencasting is an announce or an assignment, a homework assignment. That's what that little icon right there means. If I hit that, the student has already, this student's already submitted that assignment and gotten a grade of 7. The peculiar thing about assignments, homework assignments in Canvas, is that students can submit a homework assignment as many times as they wish. And you can't stop them from doing that. You can't limit the number of attempts on a homework assignment. Not quite sure what the thinking behind that particular limitation was, but anyway, the students can just keep submitting assignments to their heart's content until the assignment is locked by having the display until date pass, or you unpublish the assignment. But as long as it's published and the display until date is not passed, they can resubmit and resubmit and resubmit. And you have, you can pick the submission that you're going to grade, or you can tell them if you submit 10 times, for every time past 2 that you submit, I want to knock off 10% of the grade or something like that. That's the only way you can control that, by social engineering, as it were. But anyway, so this student could resubmit this assignment, and they can do this from their phone. This assignment was set up in Canvas to allow either text entry or file upload. And if I hit file upload here, I can choose a file. I can get it from my library on the iPhone, which is basically my photos. And that's all you used to be able to do on an iPhone, but now there's a file area on an iPhone and on an Android. Android's had it forever. iPhones didn't. And here is the files area. Tap on that. And that's the only file I have per se on this phone that's submittable. That's not germane to this particular assignment, but I can select that. And that is now ready to be uploaded. And I can just submit the assignment right here. And boom. So the students can submit homework assignments on their phones. That's really a big deal, because that was a piece that was missing until relatively recently. Hello. How might they? Yes, please.
In my anatomy class, students need to label some pictures and then show it to me somehow or send it to me. What's the best way to do it?
How do they get the pictures? Are they on, do you give them to them to download, or are they in their textbooks?
They have a lab manual. They have to draw a label in their lab manual.
Gotcha. What they can do is label the drawing in the lab manual and use their phone to take a picture of the labeled drawing.
Okay.
And when they submit the assignment, one of the options they have under file upload is to go to their photo library. They find the picture they took, tap on that, and submit it. And you will then see a picture of that, you'll see that picture in the speed grader when you grade that assignment for them.
Oh, wonderful. My last question.
I hear you.
How can you eliminate unauthorized folks to have your, say, URL?
I'm sorry, I didn't catch that.
How can you eliminate some people who have access to your URL meeting, Zoom meeting URL?
A Zoom question, yeah. Well, to start, of course, you only provide that link to people who have a reason to have it. That doesn't prevent them from sharing it with someone inappropriate, but I don't know about you, but my lectures are not so riveting that most people would just off the street would want to attend them if they didn't have to. If there weren't a strong motivation in terms of keeping their grade point average up, the chances of somebody wanting to get into a meeting that you're offering that they don't have to be in are pretty low. If it should happen and someone were to get disruptive, you have the capability in Zoom to kick them out of the meeting.
Okay.
From the participants box. If you're the host in Zoom, you can blow them right out. And I've never heard of a situation like that arising, to be quite honest, but it theoretically could. And occasionally, if you're using your personal meeting room link in Zoom, and that's published in every course you have, and you've been using it for a while, my personal meeting room link has been used for ages. It's out there. Hundreds and hundreds, thousands of people probably have that link somewhere in their email records. And every now and then somebody will pop into a meeting or something like that that I didn't expect, but it's never been especially disruptive or difficult to deal with. Again, if they don't have to be there, if they don't have a strong motivation for being there, they'll probably just leave right away. Oh my God, let me out of this. So it really doesn't typically turn out to be, or typically cause a lot of trouble.
Thank you.
Well, let's cover any questions that have to do with the mobile apps in Canvas right now before I just open things up. That's pretty much the presentation I had planned. So let me open it up for questions first about the mobile apps.
Okay,
then when we get those taken care of, we'll go on to just anything. Yes, thank you.
I have a question. Can you hear me?
Good.
Yeah, so I typed it in there earlier, but it probably got lost. So we're hearing about students who seem to have access to files that are unpublished, even though we have hidden files on the computer and in Canvas. So we're thinking it's coming through the apps. And so I know you mentioned something about having a test student that we can see, because it seems like the files aren't being hidden on the app as they are on the computer.
Well, of course, a lot depends on whether you give them access to the files.
We're not, that's what we're saying. We've dragged the files down, so it's not okay. Showing up on the Canvas on the computer, but we think we're seeing
right.
It. Okay.
Dave, I have a very similar issue. Like the on the left hand side, like I hide using my laptop, I hide it like a people, outcomes, conferences, and so on. But right. When I log in using my mobile, and when I logged in as a student,
yeah,
all those showing up.
I'm just checking to see in that course I've been using as a demonstration.
Uh-huh.
I'm just checking here to see
Helen, that if you are logging in, if you're logging in the student, but you're uh-huh. logging in with your ID, it's showing you your instructor stuff. It's giving you instructor access. So you're not a student in the class. So I know I read that online, that you can't see what a student sees because you have different access, even though it's the student, because your role is instructor.
Right.
So we need, Dave was saying, the dummy student, so we can see what they see.
I see, okay, thank you.
But what I have here is a true student.
Okay.
Okay, so let's check this. That's a good question. I'm in that course on my computer now
as
instructor. And the file and the pages link, which I see there, are visible to students right now. Let me change that. This is a fascinating question. I haven't looked into that myself. Let me go into settings. And navigation. And let me get rid of the, let me pull the Pages app and the Files app out of there. Hide them from students. And save. Now, probably I'm going to have to come out of the course and come back in as the student.
Right.
Let's see now. Go back. Let's log out and check that. I can log out. Okay. Find my school. Let's go back in from scratch as the student. San Diego. There we go. And log in. This is STUTEST1. Giving away my secrets here. STUTEST1. Password is STCCDTEST. You can see that anyway. I think I got that right. Log in. Yeah, I mistyped it. That worked. Okay, and here's that course. Now let's see what makes it in. And look at that, they're still there.
You're still there.
You're right.
and why this is a huge issue is some of us post like old exams, all kinds of stuff, and they're seeing stuff. We are finding they're seeing stuff that isn't even published under files. I mean, that's what some people have come up with. So it's kind of like, yeah, this
that's
is a
problematic. I agree.
Yeah.
I'll do some research on this and see if anybody has a workaround for it.
Yeah.
But I'm seeing the same. Well, let me try something. Let's try.
See what happens. Maybe it's there.
I got it. Yeah, it's still letting me get into them.
Yeah, click on files. Can you see what it shows you? It doesn't do a error or anything like that. Yeah. See.
Oh, okay.
All right. So now it's saying unexpected.
It's not going to let them do it. But pages, I removed the page tool too.
Yeah. I wonder if something happened like, okay, let's say the student was signed in before you hid something and now they didn't sign out. If it's still there, they still have access too. That could be something.
Well, but that could be a possibility.
Yeah, that's a little bit.
But eventually they'll have to restart the phone or something and that'll go away.
Yeah, something will happen. Right, exactly.
But the pages tool, they can still see all my pages.
Yeah.
Including ones that I haven't published. Well, actually, I wonder if a page is not published, can they see it? That may be an answer to that.
Yeah. It's still odd that it's even there.
That should be the case. If a page is not published, they should not be able to see it on the phone or on the computer, even if they do have access to the pages tool. Yeah. They should be able to get into it.
I'm going to have to leave soon. Can you, type or something that give us access to that student, fake student, test student that you just
Let me give you access to a different one.
Okay,
because that one's in so many courses right now that it could be distracting. But let's do username stutest8 and password SDCCDTEST.
Okay, thank you.
You bet, that makes it handy.
Yeah, we'll try it. Thank you, thanks for everything, bye.
You bet, take care. And of course that was a lot easier because I had my little whiteboard here. I had my document camera. I can't emphasize how handy these things are when you're trying to teach through Zoom. Let's see. There was one other thing. I'm trying to remember what it was that I wanted to share with. Oh, yes. I had a good question earlier about writing assignments. Is it realistic for students to do a writing assignment on the phone? Well, students can get for free Microsoft Word on the phone.
Well,
yes.
Dave. That fake student account is not going to work if they're not in our classes.
You can add them.
We can.
I believe so, yeah. Let me verify that. I think they changed that restriction when they had some problems with students not getting into their classes and so on before the integration was fully functional. And I think they gave you that capability, but let me check. I've got an instructor app, and I'll bring that up here. But for the moment, let me, here's Microsoft Word, okay, on the phone. And it's free. And I can start a new document, blank document. And I can type on this. But it's kind of excruciating. Have to be sensitive.
So while you're typing, I did go in and use people to add that student. And it was added to my list, currently pending. So I'm really surprised. I didn't realize that had been turned on.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We had some trouble with the integration from PeopleSoft not putting certain students in mm-hmm. when the schedule preparers had changed stuff in the middle of the term and so on. So they quietly added that capability back for faculty. For some they couldn't give it just to some faculty. They had to give it to everybody, but they just didn't publicize it. So you can add people to your course now with student access. Used to be you could only do teacher or TA adds, okay, but now you can't add
students. It's pending right now, and I assume that when it does the automatic update that it does every so many hours, that's when they'll get in?
No, they should be in immediately. What you will have to do, though, in order for them to actually appear in your class, mm-hmm. is to log in as that student.
Okay.
And there will be an invitation pending for that student at the top of the screen, and you have to accept that before they actually become active in your course.
Got it. We'll do it.
Okay. But anyway,
thank
the
you,
point
man.
Is they can type files, and they can type in text boxes in Canvas on their phones, but the process is a bit excruciating. It takes a lot of patience. Of course, students who are used to texting all the time are a little bit better at it than most of us in my age group are, but it's still a bit difficult. So I think we have to adjust our expectations accordingly, unfortunately, because too many of your students will only have those phones to satisfy their writing requirement or their writing assignments. At least with Word, and if you give them in a homework assignment, you give them file upload capability to submit. At least with Word, they can type when they're offline. They don't have to be using up their internet bandwidth and so on. They can type it and they can take their time and gradually get through it. But it's still going to be tough to type anything bigger than maybe a 300 word theme or something like that. And even that's going to be pretty challenging on a keyboard, on that little virtual keyboard like that. Yes, they can buy Bluetooth keyboards to use with the phones, but that's an expense that a lot of them won't have the money for. So one thing you can help your students with, if they're looking for perhaps tech accessories that they need to do some of this stuff and they don't want to pay top dollar for it, you can provide them, you can tell them about a site that I have used for years. I've had very good luck with. Oops, you're not seeing that. Now you are. It's techforless.com. It's a wonderful, they sell refurbished equipment, open box stuff, things that have been sold and returned. They're still that were functional. This person just didn't want them anymore, and they can't sell them for full price. So they the manufacturers sell it to retailers, third party retailers like these folks. And you can get sometimes just a wide variety of stuff from these folks: cables, accessories, computers. I've got a couple of computers around the house that I bought from them. And I've always had exceptionally good service out of this group. They're honest, they're support, they're reasonable. They do what they say they're gonna do, unlike a lot of people in this retail space. They're based in Colorado Springs. And it's a great place to go if you need some tech and you just can't pay full price for it. You can get and if you get something that doesn't work, it'll happen. I've had that happen once in 15 years. I've been using these people, and they'll take it right back with no questions asked, as long as you send it back to them in the condition that it left their warehouse in. So these people are great. All right. Let's just get back into the questions here then. I can undo my visualizer here, and I'll probably need Canvas or Zoom or something up here in a second. So let me just go and start. Uh, working my way through the questions. How can I zoom in and zoom out when I show using iPad? I answered that one, sorry. Mm-hmm. I don't see the gradebook on my iPad app. That's right, you don't, and you won't. You're hearing that some students, yes, we just dealt with this one. Okay. Snagit, we were talking about Snagit. Snagit isn't free anymore. Unfortunately not. For about a week, TechSmith got really, really civic-minded and decided to give away a limited time license for Snagit through the end of June. And they apparently got so much response the first day or two that they had to walk it back. They had to stop it. They gave out a lot of licenses over that time, but then they stopped. I can't find any reference to it online now. But the educational price on Snagit is $30, $29.95. And all you have to have is an EDU email address to get that price. You don't have to go through a lot of hoops and rigmarole and registering and all that. You can just order it online, download it, and install it, and be using it in 10 minutes for $30. And I got to tell you, I've made that, that's the one of the best tech investments I've ever made, because Snagit is a wonderful screencasting tool. Now, you might say, well, it's Zoom. Works for that too. You can screencast, you can record your screen and Zoom and save that to YouTube and so on and share it with your students. And yes, that's true. But the workflow in doing that in Zoom is a little awkward. Snagit has the best multimedia production workflow of any application I've ever seen. And if you have to do a lot of screencasting, like say you're using screencasting to give feedback to your students on homework assignments, which is a wonderful thing to do. You may be doing 40 screencasts in a night as you grade your writing assignment in your course. And with Snagit, you'll save so much time relative to using Zoom or Screencast-O-Matic or any other online screencasting tool I can think of, that it will pay for itself in one night, much less over the course of a year. And that $30 license for Snagit is a forever license. You can keep using that version of Snagit forever. And you will get, at least for the first year or so, you'll get periodic updates to it that add features or that fix bugs, things like that, for free. The next major upgrade that comes out, they will charge you if you want it. But if you don't want it and the old version you have is still working for you, as it probably will be, you can just keep using the old version and not upgrade until they come up with some new feature that you just can't live without, which they try to do routinely. But that's just life in the marketing chain. But but you can keep using that forever. It's not a subscription. It's a one-time cost. And when you do upgrade, do a major version upgrade, they usually give you half off. It's usually $15 rather than $29, again, for education. Snagit costs the civilian $50, but you get it for $30. So, sorry, it's not free anymore. I was disappointed in that, too. I was hoping to run a lot of classes on how to use Snagit, but maybe not so much now. Snagit, that is how you spell it. Is there more of information available for us? Well, you can get it on the TechSmith website. That's two questions on that, so I guess I will show you that. Go to www.techsmith.com, TechSmith.com. View products. Here's Snagit. Don't freak out over that. Just say buy now. That takes you to then go to the pricing screen. Right there. And there's an education tab. And there's your educational price, $29.95. You can install it on two computers. They're thinking you're going to install it on your office computer and your home computer, and they're fine with that. Buy now. And just then it's just the usual e-commerce transaction. You add it to the cart. You give them a credit card, and they give you a link to download the software. You download it and install it. You'll be using it in 10 minutes. Don't buy the maintenance. I can't imagine why you need it. The software never, it's not like the software gets broken or anything like that. And if you have questions about Snagit, just email me, because I use it 4 or 5 times a day. So that hopefully answered that question. And let's move on. And thanks very much, Linda, for putting that link in there. I've downloaded both instructor and student apps for Canvas. When I log in using instructor, I don't see the home page, whereas I see it using the student login. I didn't realize you saw it using the student login. That's good. You don't really need to see it. The students do. Thanks for sharing that. You can do a free trial, right? You can do a free trial with Snagit. That's true. And I think it's 15 days or something like that. So you can see if you really like the software or not. Also free are Screencast-O-Matic and Screencastify. That's true, but with Screencast-O-Matic, which is the 800-pound gorilla there, they're the number one free screencasting tool that operates through a web browser. I mean, you don't even have to install any software on your local computer to use it, other than a web browser. But Screencast-O-Matic is free, but there are a lot of restrictions in that free account. For instance, you can only record your screen. You can't record your webcam or the screen and webcam. There are a lot of other neat features that it has that you can't access in the free version. And your screencasts on the free version are limited to 15 minutes in duration, which is almost more of a fortuitous discipline than it is a limitation, because screencasts that are more than 15 minutes long typically don't get watched all the way to the end. The research shows that by the time you get to 7 minutes in a screencast, you've lost all but the most dedicated of your viewers. So limiting your screencast to making your screencast as short as possible is a virtue. And you can make a virtue out of that limitation in Screencast-O-Matic, but sooner or later, you're going to need to record one longer than 15 minutes, and you're not going to be able to. And to get the Screencast-O-Matic is very reasonable in its what it charges for its enhanced license, but it's $20 a year. Now, that's not much. You know, that's just a couple of bucks a month, or less than a couple of bucks a month. But that puts it in the same general ballpark of cost as Snagit. And Snagit, you only have to pay for it once. So if you use Snagit for a year and a half, it's cheaper than Screencast-O-Matic. But that's certainly, Screencast-O-Matic is a wonderful tool. I wouldn't diss it at all. I have used it, but I will tell you that I sometimes, during these times when I'm doing faculty support through email a lot, I will often make Snagit tutorials to answer a question. And I can do 5, 6, 7, 8 tutorials in a day when I'm really banging away at the email. And the time I save with Snagit relative to Screencast-O-Matic makes Snagit more than worth it. Anyone know how we apply for Teacher Price Camtasia? Also any on computers for students who cannot come to Canvas. Yeah, I don't have any information like that. I'd be fascinated to hear about that too. But you can get Camtasia the same place you got, I showed you getting Snagit. It's exactly, just go to products on the TechSmith website, TechSmith also makes Camtasia. Just go to, you can even get a, you can get a real deal with a Snagit Camtasia bundle because they work well together. I use Snagit with Camtasia all the time. But anyway, we can go to Camtasia. There is a free trial of Camtasia, but it's extremely limited these days. So if you buy it and go to your pricing screen and go to education, the educational license on Camtasia is $169, which is almost, well, it's a 40% discount, something like that, 30, 40% discount. So it's a great discount. But it's not, you know, now you're talking a little bit more serious money. And if you're screencasting and you're not editing your screencasts, Snagit's just as good as Camtasia. Indeed, when I do a screencast, I record the screencast in Snagit, and then if I need to edit it, I drop it over into Camtasia. But I don't bring Camtasia up every day. I do use Snagit several times a day. So I'd start off with Snagit and see if you can get by. But Camtasia has the best mid-range, call it prosumer or semi-pro video editor that I know of. It's extremely powerful. It's much easier to learn to use than professional editors like Adobe Premiere or Final Cut Pro on the Mac. And it'll do pretty much anything that anybody outside of the video industry would ever have to do. So it's a terrific tool if you want to get into video editing. That's the best reason to buy it. You can record screencasts with Camtasia as well, but the Snagit recorder is so efficient that I usually don't bother. Posting. Thank you, Eileen, for posting those resources. In Canvas Teacher, if grading a discussion, I'm getting a message that some are graded even though I haven't graded it yet. I take that, you mean that's the Canvas Teacher app, Eileen?
Sorry, yeah, it's in the app.
Uh-huh.
Let me bring it up.
Yeah.
Sorry, I was like in my student app, but when I, let me see if the lighting's good.
That's interesting.
Sorry, I was thinking. Thinking. Yeah, it was weird. I was following you along in my teacher app.
Right.
And then I was just like looking at the assignments to grade. Wait, let me go back to the discussion. And yeah, I have a discussion that's going to close out soon. So I know that I don't grade them until. And let me turn on my camera. Thank you, by the way, for the camera recommendation.
Oh, and I'll have to kill my share just a second. You going to share your screen?
Yeah.
Okay, I've killed mine.
Well, actually, I don't know. I have to shut off my virtual background. Too many things going on here.
I tell you what, while you're doing that, let me take the next question. And if it's something I can answer without sharing my screen, I'll do
it. There. Can you see it? I don't need to share my screen.
Let me spotlight your video for everybody.
Oh, okay.
This is a Zoom trick. If you're the host and somebody and you want the entire group to see something that a participant in the meeting is showing, if you want everybody to see that participant, you can go into gallery view and right click on the video that you want people to see. And pin and spotlight that video. And now, Eileen, we're all seeing your phone.
Okay, so see how I went into a discussion I'm gonna start grading it soon, but I know I haven't graded any of them. And it said 8 are graded, 13 need grading, and 0 are not submitted.
Interesting.
So
if you tap on the 8? Do you see grades?
No, that's what's so confusing. I'm like, Am I losing my mind? Did I grade them and forget?
The grades are showing as zeros.
Yeah. Isn't that weird?
And if you go into your grade book on the computer, are those... they just have the dash and the...
They're not graded. I know I haven't graded.
I'll try that on mine later and see if it does that to me.
Yeah, I was just curious. The other thing is, if I want to grade their discussion, I can't see, like, my students have to respond to at least two other people.
Right.
So, like, say I pick someone who needs grading, and I know this person always responds to people. But if you take a look, I get redirected to the student app, which is odd. Am I doing something wrong? I'm sure I am.
I don't know. You just clicked on needs grading.
Yeah, isn't that weird?
Come to think of it, I think the same thing happened to me. But you'll be logged into the student app as you, so you can actually see those.
I can see them, like if I look at the discussion itself, I mean, I can sort through them.
Well, no, but you don't want to have to do that. What the speed grader is for. And I could swear when I tried this earlier that I did see the students' posts.
Yeah, because when I'm in the speed grader on the computer, that's ideal because I can see who they're posting to and quickly grade with the
group. Right. I will take another look at that.
Okay, and thanks. See, sorry.
If I'm seeing the same thing.
Okay.
I don't recall being surprised by anything. So okay. I want to go back and look and see if it's a consistent problem.
Oh, sorry.
Ducky thanks notes. For bringing that up.
That's not my video. Okay.
All righty. Let's see now. I should be able to go in a gallery view. Yep. And unspotlight, cancel the spotlight.
Thanks.
That's a nice trick in Zoom that you can do as the host. Again, if you go to gallery view, where you see the Hollywood squares, you see everybody. And if you want to spotlight somebody so that everybody sees them for a moment, regardless of who's talking, you can just right click, or I guess control click on a Mac, over the video window for that person. And select, and of course they have to have their webcam on, you can spotlight their video so that everybody will see it until you turn that off. So it gives you some flexibility in some control over what everybody sees in a situation where you want a student to share something with the group. Okie dokie, I will look into that, Eileen. How can we restrict people that are not students from accessing my Zoom meeting? If you're using your personal meeting room ID, as I've recommended for every meeting, they basically, again, you just have to not give that out to anybody you don't want it in one of your meetings. If someone should acquire it and drop in, chances are they will drop out quickly. But if they don't, if they're problematic, in the participants tool, you can, as if you're the host in the participants tool, you can mouse over the person in question and you'll get a more button, a more menu. And on that menu is an option to remove the person from the meeting. A suggestion from Eileen, you can start your phone in a Zoom in a different room to give you more time to mute without going crazy. You're absolutely right. That's not a bad idea at all. Thanks, Eileen. Can we add to the course menu? I have links on a homepage for those categories for which I do not have a menu item. You can add links to the course menu, but the only thing they can point to are external resources like Zoom. That's how I've shown people in several sessions how to put a link to their personal meeting room URL, which is an external link to Canvas, in the Canvas course menu. You can't really put links, you can't really put anything else in there. So I guess the question here, this was Linda, what did you want to put in your Canvas course menu if you're still here? There you are.
Well, I have extensive additional documents and help keys and so forth, and I don't like having to have a home page with links to a page, right, with links to pages. I'd rather just have a menu that has helps or support, you know what I mean, where I can just go straight to them.
Well, but these documents are stored on Canvas?
Yes, they're uploaded, and then
You can't reliably link to stuff that's inside Canvas from the course menu. Canvas or Instructure had a very specific vision for that course menu. They wanted it to be as consistent from course to course as possible. And they particularly did not want to give the level of customization that was present in Blackboard to instructors. Because okay, then the course menu becomes so different.
I'm in student view. Let me see if I can do this. Yeah. And you
right,
see,
it's so different.
I had to make
basically, Linda. I'm sorry that they just won't let you do that, and we can't. You can make a suggestion to under the help button in Canvas as a suggestion for a feature idea, but I can tell you right now they're gonna ignore that one because they're very stuck on that idea. That was a very deliberate move on their part. So, at times it's inconvenient, I agree.
There's but just so much you want to provide. I'd rather have a link where I could be providing some of this.
Yeah.
You know.
They're not going to let you do that. And there's nothing we can do about that, obviously. That's a design decision made at the highest levels of the development teams and that's at Instructure. So.
I think her problem with the discussions, by the way, if there's a way to add the discussions in the assignment group, you know, how you can have the different groups and discussions as a group and then add that in the modules, I wonder if it would load it differently where you wouldn't get redirected as opposed to having discussions just launching off the board. Remember when she clicked on the student and it took her to a login?
Well, of course, you can link the discussions into the modules. And the students can access them from there. Or if there are group discussions, they can access them from the group's tool in the system menu.
I'm just wondering if it would treat them differently if they were classified under assignments, because you can just place discussions on the menu.
Graded discussions are shown in the assignments tool.
Okay.
And you can't prevent that. Also, you can't put a discussion into the assignments tool. It's not gradable. So I don't know what would happen if you made a discussion and made it gradable and gave it 0 points. That I would think that would go into the assignments tool so they could access it from there, if that would make a difference. Worth a try.
Thank you.
But again, Instructure has a very, some would say consistent, some would say narrow vision of how Canvas is supposed to work, and they're maintaining that. And that increases the simplicity of the Canvas interface, if you will. Mm-hmm. All Canvas courses look more or less alike. And that makes it easier for the students. And that is the ethic at Instructure. Whereas the ethic at Blackboard was, we're going to produce the most powerful learning management system possible. And if just a few people request a feature, we're going to throw it in.
Yeah.
And in so doing, they've produced an interface that is so complex to use.
Well, some of us got to
know. It gives power users an awful lot of capability. but the average new faculty user coming into Blackboard, for the average faculty user coming into Blackboard, it's a nightmare. And Instructure is absolutely determined not to turn Canvas into Blackboard. So that's their ethic. And that's, we're going to be dealing with that from here on out. Let's see. Students can't see the syllabus from the tab. They can't see the syllabus tool. But they can see, if you load a syllabus into a module, they can see that. Using mobile, I cannot open video links in Canvas. When I tried to open a video lecture, I got the message, clear text not permitted. Error, clear text not permitted.
Hmm. Oh, Dave?
Yes.
I'm the one who put that on.
Yes. Hey there.
When I went in as a student, then I am able to see the video.
Oh, okay.
But when I logged in as an instructor,
you can play it.
Right.
That's interesting. I think I only tried it as a student, so I didn't run into that.
Oh, one more problem.
No, I guess you don't really need to view the video. You put it up there. As long as the students can view it, we're golden.
Right. One question was that today was my first day. And
yes.
Then, like what happened right now, I didn't do anything, but then it got disconnected. So I kind of a little panicked a bit. And then I reopened, you know, the Zoom, closed it and reopened it. Do you know what triggers it? I don't even know what triggered to
I don't know. My first worry would be that it was triggered just by a burst of activity on the Zoom servers and they just dropped the session.
Oh, I see. Okay.
we'll just have to see if that sort of thing continues or gets worse. I hope not. But we're all living in fear of that because so many more people are using Zoom now.
Right. Thank you, Dave.
Yeah. Let me know if that, alert me if that happens to you a lot, will you?
Okay. Thank you. Yes.
I'd really like to know. Thank you. You said students can see videos on their mobile devices if they've uploaded them into a page, if you've uploaded them into a page. Can they also see video on mobile devices that are in modules? Yes, they can see them. Videos embedded on pages in Canvas can be viewed through the student mobile app. And I think I showed that at one point. Oh, Eileen, did you still, you found that link active for Snagit?
Yep, I did.
I just brought it up. I wonder if they'll still respond to it. It's worth a try. Thank
I
you very much
so.
For putting that in there. I just clicked on that link and brought it up, as you're seeing.
Yeah, because then people can try it for longer. Yeah, they can try it for longer. And then if they like it, I mean, I think once you start using it, you end up liking it so much. $30 is really cheap for it.
That's what they're counting on.
Yeah, well, plus they're going to get rid of Jing. So those of us who really, really love Jing more than Snagit, because we don't need all that functionality sometimes, we've been getting messages saying they're going to disable it.
Because it's almost worthless anymore. Because Jing produces video recordings that require the Flash Player to play. And almost nobody has the Flash Player on their computers anymore, the Adobe Flash Player, because it's a security risk. And Flash is just about dead. Apple just about single-handedly killed Flash by not letting Flash work on the iPhone. So that's a technology whose time has passed. And Jing can only produce Flash-based videos, Adobe Flash-based videos. And so it's effectively dead. And Snagit is the tool that they created. Well, actually, Snagit's been around a long time, but it was originally a static screenshot tool. You could take pictures, still images of your screen, and annotate them and edit them, and then post them or use them in documents and so on. And about 5-6 years ago, TechSmith added video recording, screencasting capability to Snagit. And at that point, they walked away from Jing, because Jing was just cannibalizing their market for Snagit. So Jing's dead. So Snagit is the new Jing. And instead of absolutely free, it's only $30 to educators. So that's it. Thank you so much. I had not been able to find that link online anywhere, but it is still up on their website. So I'm hoping that it is still active. If you all can save the chat tool. Most of you probably know that. Save the chat log in the lower right-hand corner of the chat box. Is a little ellipsis, three dots and a line.
When I click on,
when you click those that ellipsis in the lower right-hand corner of the chat box, you'll get an option to save your chat tool, and do that before you leave, so you'll have all these good links that Eileen has put in there. Yes, Helen.
Was it just me that it got dropped? So when I click on the chat box, it's all blank. Is it just me?
Oh, no, I'm still seeing it.
Oh, do you still see it?
Oh, so it's just me that got dropped and I got to read.
I'm sorry. I don't know what might have caused that. Yeah.
Okay.
If you're still in Zoom, Helen, just try clicking on that little chat icon down in the middle of your Zoom screen again. It might have just
try minimized. Opening it up again.
Yeah, I opened it again.
Make sure you don't have like participants and all those other things open, because that shrinks the chat window. At the bottom of your screen, do you see invite, participants, share, chat, and all that?
Participants, invite, yes,
So the only one that you really want marked is chat. And we don't have share screen. Well, it's there. So if participants is marked, then that will shrink your chat window.
Helen, if you remember, when you leave the when we finish up later, if you'll remember to just send me an email, I'll send you the chat log.
Okay.
I'll save it. Okay.
Helen, to close, participants, just click on that participants link at the bottom of your Zoom window, and that will close the participants, so it should expand your group chat window.
Oh.
Right.
Like a light switch.
What is unstable network? I get this sometimes using Zoom. That means your ISP is not providing you the quality of access to the internet that you need. I used to get that all the time up here in Northern Idaho when I had a poor internet connection. So that's a problem on your local internet, your local internet service provider's network. Hopefully it won't happen too often. Zoom is pretty tolerant of low bandwidth and fluctuating bandwidth. It works quite well even on cellular internet connections most of the time. But if the connectivity gets squirrely enough, or if the bandwidth gets low enough, it will complain. At least it will warn you that it may be happening. And you can ask your participants, you know, can you still see me? Can you still hear me? But unfortunately, with the crushing load on both internet connectivity and in general, and Zoom in particular right now, we're always concerned that could start to be a problem. Can you check if the students can see your unpublished files and pages? I'm pretty darn sure that if a file or a page is not published, that the students will not be able to see it, mobile, on the computer, anything. I've never seen that happen. Password again for the StuTest 8 student was SDCCDTEST, SDCCD test.
Yeah, Dave?
Yes, Helen.
I tried to test it. So the ID was StuTest, STUTEST number 8, right?
Numeral 8.
Right.
And the password is SDCCD test.
But I get the invalid message I get when I type it in. When I try to go as a student, and the school is SDCCD, and then for the ID, I put STU, T-E-S-T, number 8. And then
just eight. Just 8, no numeral,
right, right.
No
number eight. Sign. Right. No number sign. S-T-U-T-E-S-T, 8. And the password is S-D-C-C-D-T-E-S-T.
Oh, my.
Uh-oh. And then when I say go.
One of my colleagues has apparently changed that password. Just a second, I'll fix that.
It says invalid.
Thanks for letting me know. I'll fix that momentarily.
Okay.
That's a shared resource. We all use it, and somebody's apparently changed the password, maybe in making a video to show how to change a password or something like that. Yeah. And not changed it back. So let me fix that. Thank you for letting me know. I'll get that done before I get an email or 10 emails telling me I can't get in. They were all of them originally had that password. Yeah. All right, now let me try that. Sorry, working offline here. I got it. Okay, should work now. Sorry about that. Eileen, Dave, can we link to Google Classroom? I have people asking about that. Maybe that is something that might help. Linda, about links. Of course, you're welcome to use any resource that you desire to use. And nobody's going to tell you you can't use Google Classroom, but we can't support it. And your students will not have any training materials or anything like that, except what they can find online themselves. So that's a resource that we just can't support. We're having a hard enough time supporting the ones that we use at the district. Right. And your students would have no exposure to Google Classroom, whereas many of them will already have used Canvas and other courses. So I would strongly recommend continuing with Canvas and living within whatever limitations that Canvas provides, because Canvas provides so many positives as well. Google Classroom has nowhere near the capability of Canvas. Dave, I've had problems adding rubrics to an assignment. I added them twice, but they disappeared. Whoa. Not good. Let's pull up rubrics here. Let me get back into Canvas as me. Stu Test 8's not going to be able to do anything with that.
Can you hear me?
I hope. Yes, I can.
Good. I had to leave. I thought I was going out to get something from a store, and guess what? They're out. What a surprise.
Oh, bless your heart. No kidding.
And wanted to come back and ask a few questions.
Good. Well, we're still here. Still
I know. Kicking. Thank you.
You bet. Yeah, I know. We're trying to stay, you know, real early or real late going to stores when there's nobody but us and the stock people there.
I can imagine it's similar here, but it's hard to find bread anyplace locally. We can find other things. And so even flour and other staples. And I got some flour from a restaurant supply place because we have friends who own a restaurant. They're running, they hardly have any yeast left and no one else has yeast. So I can't even bake.
I hear you.
It's crazy. Some the day.
I got some yeast and some. I bought a big sack of flour early on from a restaurant supply place because I could find it there.
Yeah, smart thing to do.
But yeast, yeah, everything's getting hard to find. I empathize.
Yeah, you can try making Irish soda bread because it doesn't use
yeast. There you go.
That's a good idea. That's a good
idea.
And we don't actually eat much bread, but I want to be able to have it if necessary.
Absolutely.
If
besides,
you can,
baking bread smells so good. Okay.
Yes. Yeah. Or make a sourdough starter if you can.
If I can find it.
Oh, now that, yeah, I guess when we're off and we're at home and we have the time to really look after it, the sourdough starter might be an option. That's not for the faint of heart. I've never had much luck with that myself. I love to bake bread, but I've never had any luck with sourdough. Okay, let's find an assignment here. I think I had one. This might have had a link to it, or might have had a rubric to it. Yep, there it is. Are you sure when you finished your building of the rubric that you clicked update rubric? Because any number of times I've made rubrics and navigated away from the screen and lost them.
Huh. I don't even think that was an option. I was looking around. It says create rubric.
Well, this at the bottom, it would say if you're making a new rubric, it would say create rubric.
Right.
So other than forgetting to click that button, I don't know what would have caused the rubric not to save.
And you can do it without putting points in, and using the remove points from rubric, because I did that.
Yes, you. Oh, and that was successful. But when you put points in the rubric, it didn't create it.
Actually, no, it was the opposite. There were points in there, and then I had remove points from rubric because I need to grade them manually.
Right.
Obviously. And, oh, interesting. I have it up on a different screen.
I understand.
I'm trying to get three screens right now, and I only have two. So you have all three, right?
Do you know how to put the third screen on?
My husband probably does. I'm not sure the video card we have.
There's a device that will operate through a USB port, a USB 3 port, called I think it's called display card or something like that. That's the technology.
Huh.
And that's what I'm using here. You plug it into a USB 3 port, and it's a little sealed box, and it's got an HDMI or a VGA connector on the other end. You plug your monitor cable into that and plug your monitor cable into the monitor and load some drivers. And Windows, and I think the Mac as well, will recognize that as another screen, and it performs great.
Good.
And you can put up to about 4 to 6 screens.
Wow.
Depending on the speed of the computer.
Right.
Using extras, a separate display card adapter for each one.
We know people who've done flight simulators with probably 4 or 5 screens.
Yeah, but you could buy video cards that have multiple monitor outputs, more than 2 monitor outputs.
Right.
They're quite expensive. The display card adapters are like 60, 70 bucks, something like that, or less.
I think we were looking at them, the more expensive video cards with the three, option for three monitors.
If you send me, Amazon tried to sell me one this morning. I bought one some years ago. So if you're interested, if you want to send me an email, I'll send you the link to it.
I was going to say, yeah, when this is over, I probably do. I'm just reconfiguring my desk.
Gotcha. And it's really nice when you're teaching like this on Zoom to have 3 screens or even more.
Yeah.
You've got a big desk if you have more than one.
I've got a corner desk, and I used to teach on Blackboard all the time and do live chats.
Right.
And I'd keep certain things on different screens so I could bring them over quickly.
Well, if the price on a Matrox card is one of the brands, those high-end video cards and so on, if price on that gets to be hard to swallow, send me an email and I'll send you the cheap solution. And I have used this same adapter for about 4.5 years now and never had any trouble with it. And
that's good.
The screen looks just as good as any of the others. I forget which one is the one running off the USB. So it does work. They do work.
I probably will.
Okay, great. All right. I seem to have gotten to the bottom of the chat box. And it's only like half an hour after we were supposed to have finished. That never happened.
My question is, I still can't find the save. The save for the rubric or change rubric. Let me try putting something in. Because on mine, I'd put in the criteria. And as I said, there wasn't an option.
Mm. Yike.
Which is weird.
That is odd.
New criteria. And I put in the add criteria. And I'm going to do it as a test.
Right. Let me find an assignment. Just put some kind of unrealistic rubric into it or something. Let's see while you're doing that. Here's my writing assignment.
Now, do you have to go into the speed grader for it to show up, or should it?
No, it should show up in the, if you look at my screen, I've just clicked add rubric to a dummy assignment in my course. I'm on the rubric page.
And I'm seeing your video and versus your desktop right now.
Probably because I haven't shared my screen. Thank you. Okay. Now you can see my screen.
Yay. Okay.
Right, let me cancel out of this. All right. This is just a standard assignment. I just went to the assignment page that I created. And I clicked add rubric.
Mm-hmm.
And there's my create rubric button down there.
Mm-hmm.
And as I add criteria and things like that, the create rubric remains.
And then I put the remove points as well. Yeah. Yep. So there's no point, which is fine. But then there was no place to save it.
Well, that's the create rubric button is still showing here. So I don't know why that would be. It would not be there. When crazy, inexplicable things begin happening in web tools like Canvas or Blackboard or any of them, you immediately start suspecting web browser cache problems.
Mm-hmm.
Where the web browser is not updating its cache properly. And about the only way to fix that is to clear the browser cache and then close the browser, bring it back up again, close all the browser windows from that browser, and then bring it back up again. And sometimes that will solve that problem. What web browser are you using?
I've been using Chrome. And
Chrome is the one that's most compatible now. Everybody designs for Chrome. So on Chrome, I think you're seeing my video. If you go to the options screen, to settings, I'm sorry. I'm thinking Firefox. Where is that? Oh, it's history. That's what I want in Chrome. History. Go to history, Chrome. And then go to the main history link and clear browsing data.
Okay.
Over on the left. And this is something that it's a good idea to do periodically anyway, because your browser cache can get so big that it starts to affect the performance of the browser. And you can clear browsing history, cookies, cached images, and files. That's usually plenty. And then just click clear data. And it may take quite some time if it's been a while since you've done that.
Right.
And I've probably just cut myself off. Probably just fall off a limb while I was standing on it. I didn't think of that. I can always use Firefox for a minute.
Funny.
It will improve your browser performance a bit. And it will get rid of a lot of disk space, disk usage. And it will make glitchy problems a little less likely.
Okay, I'll try that. Thank you.
It's worth a try. I can't guarantee it'll help, but it's
yeah.
Well, we you know, have to do that with Blackboard all the time, but
right. Kansas
is much less vulnerable to that mm-hmm. sort of thing. But I don't think it's invulnerable either.
Now, I have one other question, which is about the grade sheet. And I was in the grade sheet workshop the other day and asked whether or not you can use percentages or points. And of course, you can use percentages. But in Blackboard, I don't know, because they use the same grading. I don't know if they changed it, but I used to send everything for percentage and 100 points. And then I could, at the top, weight each particular assignment. So that, in other words, this assignment, I'm giving 10%. But they get, so let's say they get 80% on the test, but then that 80% only counts toward 15% of the grade overall. Right.
Yes, you can weight in Canvas, you can weight assignment groups, which
okay.
are directly equivalent to grade categories in Blackboard.
Okay.
But you, if you want to weight individual assessments, you, of course, just weight it by the number of points you give to
okay.
it.
Okay. So I should...
But if you want to weight by groups, you can weight assignment groups without...
Okay.
And then you can just give everything a grade of a total points possible of 100.
Right.
And you can apply the weights through the assignment groups.
Interesting.
And I can show you that. Since... You asked the question. We're at the end of the chat tool here.
I think I got all of them. Yep, there's Eileen's non-yeast bread recipes. Eileen, I'm saving the chat right now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry.
And
get a little lucky.
No, sorry. Thank you.
I like it.
Love it. Okay, so my Chrome is out of action for the moment.
I know.
Having been an idiot. Not for the first time in my life.
In the meantime, meantime, I'm saving that link.
Tomorrow, it won't be the last time. So let me go to Firefox. Firefox will work fine for most things in Canvas, though I do find that I have fewer issues in everything with Chrome anymore, because Chrome's by far the most commonly used web browser, and everybody designs for Chrome. And then they try to make it work without all the other browsers. And sometimes they're more successful with Chrome than they are with the others. But I can show you this certainly in Firefox. And I am sharing my screen, yes. And thanks so much. In any of these sessions, if I do something stupid, please call me out on it. I appreciate it. It certainly won't be the first time it's happened. All righty. Let me find a course that actually has some grades in it here. There we go. Introduction to screencasting. Okay. The first thing you have to do if you want to weight your grades by assignment group, is to create assignment groups. When your blank shell comes to you, if you click on the assignments button, you just see one assignment group. Here I have an assignment group called test, and I have one called discussions. It looks a little bit like a module. That's an assignment group. And here's another assignment group that I've put my homework assignments in. That's one way to subdivide your assessments. But when you get a blank course, it just has one assignment group here, which is entitled assignments, plural. And if you make quizzes or assignments or homework assignments or graded discussions in the course, they all go into that same assignment group. And there's no distinction between them.
Right.
Or there's no grouping of them by type. And that works fine. If you weight your grades, if you weight your gradebook computations or weight your assessments by just assigning a number of points, like if one assessment should have twice the weight of another, the first assessment is worth 10 points, you make the second assessment 20 points,
that's weighting your grade computation.
Right.
Because in the grade book, Canvas will just go through and create a and compute a percentage of points earned versus points possible for each item, and then average them all together accordingly. And basically what it does is add up all the numerator, adds up all the points earned by the student, and then adds up all the possible points for all the assignments, and divides the big number and the little number and multiplies by 100, and it gets a percentage. And you've weighted the grade by assigning different numbers of points to each individual assessment. And that's simple conceptually, but it's a pain when you're making the grade, when you're making the assessments in the first place, because you got to think, oh, this is a quiz. How much should it be worth relative to a chapter exam or a final exam and so on? The other option is to not worry about that when you're creating assessments. You just make everything worth 100 points. And then you apply the weights to the assignment groups. But then you have to create additional assignment groups, which you can do under the assignments tool right here, add group. And you can create as many assignment groups as you like. You could create an assignment group for quizzes, and one for chapter tests, and one for the final exam that would only have that one final exam in it, but that's fine. An assignment group can have just one assessment in it. You might have an assignment group for all of your homework assignments, or you might subdivide them into different types of homework assignments with different weights and so on. You can have as many assessment groups as you like, and the distribution of assessments among those can be as granular as you like. And you just, when you create an assignment group and you want to move stuff into it, I'll call this sample group. That'll be down at the bottom here. To put stuff into it, all I have to do is drag them down, drop them into it. So nice. There's no big deal about assorting your various assessments you've created into the different assignment groups you create. So that's the first step, is to make as many assignment groups as you need and call them what you want to call them, and then assort your assessments among them appropriately. What I've done here is a fairly simple, I'm going to delete that assignment group so it doesn't muck up what I'm trying to show you. And this imported assignments group here, I'm just going to drop this. That's a homework assignment. I'm just going to drop that in there and get rid of this one too. Mm-hmm. The moment, just to keep things simple. So I have a fairly simple arrangement of assessments here. I've put all my quizzes and tests into an assignment group that I call test. I've put my gradable discussions into an assignment group I call discussions. And I did this manually. Originally, I just had all of the assignments in one assignment group. And I made new assignment groups, and then I reassorted the assessments between them. And then all of my homework assignments are in this one labeled assignment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we're good so far?
Yes.
That's the hard part. Or that's the work involved anyway. Now, in the assignments tool, I go to this totally unmarked menu option up here. This is one of the few instances of where the Canvas interface is not fully intuitive. I just click on that and I get an option to assign assignment group weights.
That's where they hit it.
That's where they hit it really well. I had to go to Google and type in how do I weight assignments in Canvas in order to figure that out. I did not find it either. So what you do here is you initially, when you go in there, there'll be nothing here.
Mm-hmm. And there'll be no weights in any of your assignment groups. You just click this box that says weight final grade based on assignment groups. And then you get each of your assignment groups listed, and you get a box into which you can type the weighting percentage that you want to use.
Perfect.
And of course they have to add up to 100.
Right.
But you just do that and click save. And now you can not worry about how many points possible you assign to each assessment. You can just give them all. It really doesn't matter what the points possible are. Canvas is going to do all the arithmetic right. for you. A quiz could have 30 points in it, or it could have 100 or whatever. It wouldn't matter now.
And you're I always use 100%, you know, 100 on each and then graded each one by percentage. In the really old days with Blackboard, at the top of the grade book, you could go in and figure out your percentages there. It gave you the option. But I haven't used Blackboard for quite some time because I taught at National and a couple of other colleges, but then Miramar's been keeping me so busy, I haven't been there, and I haven't been teaching online for Miramar, probably because I didn't want to go through the 40-hour class.
Blackboard these days looks, most of the installations look nothing like what we remember from the old Blackboard. They've gone largely to Blackboard Ultra, they call it. And the interface looks a whole lot like Canvas, but it doesn't work nearly as well.
Interesting. Now, I had one other weird question. Two. Uh-huh. Once people start putting their assignments in, can you change anything in the gradebook? And also, I haven't put all the assignments in. I've got two classes that I'm transitioning. And so as I add assignments during the class, they'll go into the gradebook. But once somebody actually...
They will.
Submits as an assignment, can they can we change it? And I can also put in points, right? Because I had some students who had they were in the middle of submitting a written assignment, so some of them have already sent it to me or submitted right. it, where some of them haven't. So I made an assignment for it, of course, and said they could put it in text or online, but
there are things you can change and things you can't.
Okay.
And Canvas will not let you change anything that would impact grades assignments that have already been submitted.
Okay. Interesting.
So if it will let you change it, it's almost certainly safe to do so.
Okay. Now, on my other class, I've only put in two assignments so far, but there's right. still a third column that says assignments. And I don't know what that's going to.
Does it look something like this? Let me go to my gradebook here. Well, this one's such a mess, but let me find the total column. Where did I put that? Sorry, did I move that up front? No. Oh, slower. There we go, total. Does it look like this, like these here?
It just says assignments, yes. But actually,
That's the assignment group in your course.
Okay.
That's that default assignment group I mentioned by default, and you can't change it.
Okay.
Canvas in your grade book, the students don't see this, but in your grade book, Canvas will show a column for each of your assignment groups, and it will show you what percentage of the points in that, how the students are doing in that assignment group. So this student has done not as well in the tests as they've done in the discussions and the homework.
Right,
So that's what that is. That's your assignment groups.
So I don't have, for instance, I have a research paper and discussion topic so far, and the first six discussion topics, and the thing is that they have a choice. Normally they have a choice, and so I'll just put in a total because they may not do every discussion. So it's interesting, as I said, I used to be really good at the old Blackboard, but things definitely have changed. So,
Canvas gradebook is generally easier to use, but it has, shall we say, it has different capabilities.
Has a few quirks, it sounds like.
They all do, yeah. And this one is, but the
category or assignment group weighting is just amazing. It's so simple.
Once that's you set great.
That, your grades then can be computed very effectively. You also, of course, have the option with Canvas Gradebook, as you did with Blackboard, to export your gradebook to Excel and add much more complicated grade computation rules and let those happen in Excel and then upload the results back into Canvas.
I may have to do that with some of the assignments where some students have submitted them and others are going to be submitting them into Canvas. I'll see, but yeah. I'll just make sure that they actually get the grades that they should get in case I mess something
always
up here.
Do one by hand to make sure you're doing it right. And you can use your test student for that.
Yes.
If you go to the student view, your test student shows up at the bottom of your grade book.
Okay. Actually, I haven't. I do have a test student. How do you set those up? I've just gone to the student view a couple of times.
All you have to do is go into student view, and when you leave, don't reset the student.
Okay.
And it creates them a row in the grade book.
Great.
You can go into student view and take tests and submit homework assignments, or to even participate in discussions. And then grade those attempts, and those grades will appear in the grade book. So you can, trick with the test student, and we had the same thing in Blackboard. An old trick with the test student is to go through and manually enter grades for the test student that are perfect, 100% on each one, and then check the grade computation at the end in the total column and see if it comes out to 100%.
That's funny because I do that in Excel all the time.
If it doesn't, then you've got problems.
Then I better go back to math class.
That's much less likely to happen in Canvas than it would in Blackboard. Because in Blackboard, you had a little more fiddle room than you have in Canvas. So.
That's funny. No, I always do that. I always do have a just put 100% in each to make sure that it comes out right.
That's
perfect.
Nothing like checking it by hand, is there?
Yeah, exactly. Well, thank you so much.
Okay, still got a few folks here. Anybody else have a question?
Hey, Dave.
Yes, Eileen.
Is there a way to keep the Canvas gradebook from assigning 100?
You're breaking up a little bit.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
Okay, I'll type it. Can you hear me better?
No, your audio is not coming through, and you just froze for a second. Sorry about that.
Let's see. Is it better? No, not better.
Well, that's some better, yeah. We're starting to get words instead of just little bops.
okay.
Now you're coming through.
Okay. Everyone must be online.
Quite possible.
Okay. So is there a way in the gradebook for Canvas to keep it from assigning 100% if you haven't graded it yet? Because when the students look at their grades, if I haven't graded it yet, the math calculates the ungraded assignments as 100%. And so they get an inflated sense of where they are.
No, you can't alter that, unfortunately.
Okay, thanks. Not a big deal. I guess it's better they think they're doing better than worse.
Right. But it does ignore unsubmitted assignments.
Okay.
So it ignores them in the computation entirely. If you want an assignment to be averaged in as a zero, you have to enter a zero manually into the assignment.
Okay, great. Thank you.
All righty. Anybody else?
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Oh, it's great. This was a very calm session compared to some of the ones we had last week.
I was in a couple of those.
Oh yeah, I remember it. It was quite exciting, but as we move forward, hopefully it will be a little bit more like this.
I have an old webcam that does not work with this particular setup I have, and I've got a couple laptops, but it's more convenient not to use them. I'd rather have my several monitors.
I hear you.
So I've been trying to buy a new webcam and also a document camera, and there are none to be had.
Today, Amazon had the iPivo $99 document.
Really? I may get that. Yeah.
Earlier today. But webcams, the best I was able to find on webcams was on Best Buy, and Best Buy promises that you can pick them up in the store on April 1st.
Wow.
And that's the best option I've found. There is another option for webcams. Let me see if I can show it to you.
Thank you.
That might get you over. Let me find the get things set up here. Just hoping it works today. I don't know if this will work while I'm using another webcam in a Zoom meeting or not. This the little application you see on the screen is called Epoch Cam, and it's an app. It's a driver that you load on a Windows machine or a Mac, and an app that you put on your smartphone. And there we go. If both your computer and your smartphone are on the same Wi-Fi network, which normally they would be, you can now use your smartphone.
And actually, I'm seeing you instead of your screen.
Yeah, let me. That's right. Just a second.
Okay.
Let me switch cameras. Oh, that's right. Well, let me do that right now. It's only gonna let me use the back camera, isn't it? Yeah. Okay, just a second. Oh, shoot. I just knocked it off. Darn it. I touched the wrong thing. Excuse me just a second.
I think we've been saying a lot worse for the last week or so.
There we go. Okay, now let me stop my am I stopping my screen share? No, I'm not sharing my screen. Okay, now... In Zoom, a second, I'm getting this, trying to get this set up so that I don't have to hold it. There we go. Now, if I go into Zoom, I can switch, and I can't show you this, but I can switch webcams. You can have multiple webcams attached to a computer, and Zoom can use each one in turn. That's not the one I wanted. Oh, I stopped my video. There. Nope. Shoot. Yeah. Come on. It's a little twitchy. Let me see if the viewer is still working. Yep. Come on. I know you're just seeing a black square right now. This worked fine the other day, but isn't that always the way? There I am.
Great.
Finally, now that's coming off the camera in my smartphone. The computer is recognizing that as a webcam, and applications like Zoom can use that webcam. Sometimes it takes everything a few minutes to sync up. But that will give you the option of having a webcam if you use the camera in your cell phone. And there's an Android and an iOS version of the app. Though I understand the iOS version was built first and it's a little bit more powerful. But the Android version is supposed to work fine.
Huh. And I have Android.
And the And you can have a you can have a webcam in lieu of your old one there.
That's the nice.
The pro version of the app, which I would recommend, cost $8.
I think I can afford that.
It's a lot cheaper than a document camera, especially if you catch the suckers gouging you like that.
I know.
I saw people selling C920 webcams for $300 on Amazon at one point. They originally retailed for about $70.
I've seen webcams today, actually document cameras, that were up to $2,000. And I think they were at Best Buy. I looked around different places.
Well, yeah,
they're in stock.
You can pay $2,000 for a document camera, but I ain't going to do that. my limit's about the $100 for the iPivo camera. But check Amazon when we get off that one. This morning, that one was available for Prime delivery.
Interesting. Yeah, and I bet up there you have Prime. I have a friend who doesn't drive, and she gets almost everything through Amazon.
Even up here, we have it.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, they're building an Amazon fulfillment warehouse over in Spokane, Washington, which is about 80 miles from here.
Not bad.
We're looking forward to when things settle down to one-day delivery on Prime.
That's great. Well,
out here in the backwoods, which right. You can see behind me.
I have a relative, actually my husband's sister and her husband. He's a pilot for Delta and flies, and they bought 20 acres in Montana. And they're way out in the middle of nowhere. And unfortunately,
I'm 25 miles from Montana.
Wow. Well, and the problem was that when he was on a trip, she was bitten by a rattlesnake a few years ago. And fortunately, they had one of the neighbors there. The neighbors aren't that close, but at least they were there. And they drove her into, I want to say Billings, but then they had to life flight her into a bigger hospital.
Yeah, so, we made sure our insurance had the life flight coverage.
Absolutely.
They have to fly us about 60 miles to Coeur d'Alene.
Yeah.
If we have anything complicated going on, we're fortunate enough to have a hospital nearby, but it's not that big a one.
It's small. Yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Interesting. Well, thank you very much. And I'll be using some of these things, but my first chat's tomorrow night. And when I went to sign up for Zoom, they said there was a delay of 72 hours, but they got back to me right away. So that was good.
Yeah, they're doing much better than that most times now.
Well, you know, here in San Diego, things have been so crazy that a lot of the delivery services are discontinued. And we have a couple friends who are disabled and they can't even get groceries. They're having to have friends go out and buy them groceries with whatever they can, you know, whatever they can find. But it's crazy. So you may be actually in better shape.
Most of our friends are older than we are here, and we always call them before we go out, we risk the grocery stores and pick up things for them, and they're doing that for us. It's one of those.
I think this is bringing out
situations.
Yeah, it's bringing out the best of people and then the worst of some others, unfortunately. But always, we won't talk about that.
Always the way it works, I'm afraid. Yeah.
Hey Marcy, before you leave,
yes.
I posted Dave's tutorial in the chat. Where he shows his hack for using his cell phone as a doc cam.
Perfect. I have it already. Thank you.
Okay.
I appreciate it. And you're down at City?
I'm down at City.
Okay, great. I've been at Miramar for years. I started teaching for the police academy. And then they asked me to teach in the Administration of Justice program. But I teach a forensic class and I have to do some demonstrations. Fortunately, they had a few practical things while we were in the classroom, but my neighbors are going to think I'm crazy because, well, they know what I do pretty much, but we're in a rural area and I have to do a blood spatter demonstration.
Look like you're filming an episode
exactly.
of Dexter, huh?
Exactly. And there are a couple of others that I've already done, thank goodness, but usually the students really like it. I found the best fake blood because One program I taught in a master's program, they used real blood, but then of course you've got all the biohazard issues.
Exactly. No, thank you.
and I had to find the best type of blood to clean up because some of the fake blood stains.
Right.
And if some of it went off, I'd do it on butcher paper with it. I put everywhere, but some of it was off. And the poor custodians up at Miramar, you know, they know when I have one of these classes because they have all this blood. And we try to clean it up from the bathroom because it gets all over your, I have students who are kind of practicing different things and it gets all over the counter. But they have the paper that's in the trash cans that looks like there's been a massacre.
And now our challenge is to make all this work online.
Yes. But anyway, thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
You're certainly welcome. Thank you for attending and for all the good questions. And I did just put the link to Epoch Cam in the chat tool. Don't forget to save that before you leave if you
wonderful
want any of those links.
Yeah.
And as you can see, there's sometimes you have to wait. Oh, and if you decide to try that, something they don't tell you in the setup is that once you install the drivers on your desktop PC, you have to reboot the PC before it will work. I spent a couple hours and exercised my vocabulary a little bit before figuring that out and then just rebooting. So,
I understand.
As you can see, the quality is surprisingly good. The white balance leaves something to be desired. I'm not really that pink.
No.
But the resolution and so on is really quite good.
Yes, it is.
Because the camera in the phone is really probably better than the camera in most webcams. So
you're probably right.
It does work well. All righty. Well,
thank you so much.
Stay safe. I'll hope to see you in another meeting soon. And take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Yeah, thank you. Bye-bye.